questions about anything else that I've done in my career.
Except I will have to be a bad cop and jump in if you guys ask any spoilery questions. So, you know, just let's avoid those, all right, in advance. All right, Loki, you're up.
So, Ms. Lily, I just want to say it's an honor to be talking to you. That's, that sounds weird. And then your last movie, that Wasp, Your Awesomeness. And maybe I'm Tolkien crazy here, but it would have been lost without you. Okay, I'm done.
Well done, well done.
Well done.
So my question is, could you tell me about the casting process and what your first impression of the script was and how your character stood out?
For Ant-Man and the Wasp?
Yes, for Ant-Man and the Wasp.
Well, I was just finishing up on my press tour for The Hobbit when my manager called me and said, I got a call from Marvel, and they're wondering if you might want to meet and see if this new franchise, Ant-Man, might be appealing to you. And I laughed. And I said, have they run out of superheroes and now they're making them up? Because I'd never heard of Ant-Man. I genuinely thought it was a joke. And then he was like, no, this is like, he's one of the original Avengers. This is the real thing. And so then I was like, well, the truth is, I was just a super elf. I don't really need to be a superhero. And he goes, hang on, hear me out. Ant-Man will be played by Mr. Paul Rudd, and it will be directed by the Edgar Wright. And I was like, hold the phone. Who is making this movie? This sounds awesome. And why is a superhero going to be Paul Rudd? And why is Edgar Wright directing it? I love this. What is happening in my life? And then I said, okay, I have to do some homework. I need to watch a Marvel movie and find out what these cool dudes are up to, because they sound really cool. So then I spent a weekend, I think I watched 6 Marvel movies in one weekend, and was like, I'm in! I don't know how I've missed all of this, but this is so cool, and yes, I want to do this.
Thank you. Can someone help this young person? Yeah, there you go, thank you. You look great, awesome. You look great, by the way. So what's your question?
My question is, which person did you like playing better, Toriel or the Wasp?
Ooh, tough question.
Okay, I'm going to answer this very diplomatically. I enjoyed the process of living and breathing Middle Earth for a year, more than almost anything else in my entire career. And as a fan and an audience member, I could watch either Ant-Man film over and over ad nauseum. Thank you, Wasp.
I mean, it's certainly, Ant-Man and the Wasp, like, it's important. And it feels important because we're seeing, like, the truly, like, the first female superhero that we're getting out of the MCU. So, you know, yeah, I mean, like, and of course we have Black Widow as well, but she didn't have superpowers, okay? That importance must not have been lost on you, that you get to, like, wear the super suit and kick some butt.
Well, I mean, obviously there are incredible women in the MCU, and I have a huge crush on Okoye. She might be my favorite. But being in the title and being the first titular, as they say, female superhero in the MCU is an incredible honor, and it came at such an important time. And that might seem, from the outside, very calculated. Might seem like men at the top of a company thinking, oh, okay, now we're going to want movies about a woman, so let's put a woman in the title and let's follow with the trend of, you know, the Time's Up movement and moment. But we started shooting this film about 4 months before the Harvey expose broke. And we had been planning and writing and preparing this film for 2 years before that, and I was sent the title card 2 months before we started shooting. So I can attest to the fact that this was just in Kevin's heart. This is what he wanted to do. This was his conviction long before it became the thing. thing to do, and I'm very proud of that, and I'm very proud that he was sort of, I think, as an artist, I think artists are often on the pulse of the common consciousness and where we're headed, and they're often prophetic. And I think you see that a lot in sci-fi, you see that a lot in fantasy, is that there's a lot of prophecy in those works. And I feel like Kevin is still an artist, and in his heart he just felt something in his bones and he followed that, and then this movie came out at a very important moment, and I'm very proud to be at the helm of that.
I wanted to ask if you had had a background in athletics and how you prepared physically for the archery and martial arts and things like that.
I have always been, since, you know, I was, when I remember I was 8 years old and discovering, realizing on the playground playing boys chase girls that none of the boys could catch me.
Yeah!
And I had this really, really long braid. This is a total off-topic side note, but I had this hugely long braid and it was flat behind me because I would run so fast. So the only way they could catch me is if they grabbed the end of my braid and I would go feet over head every time it happened. But, you know, that sort of began a lifetime of feeling the thrill of using this instrument that I've been graciously given to be as alive as I can be. And so I've always been somebody who loved fitness. I was a soccer player in high school, and I was the only 15-year-old in the school weightlifting gym, lifting weights. And I've just always really loved and cared about this instrument, this body, because it's a gift, and I never want to take it for granted. So when I prepared for any role, really usually it was about learning techniques a lot more than getting in shape. It was a lot about learning how to shoot a bow and arrow, which I kind of knew a bit about before. You know, I'd never done Muay Thai or MMA or anything like that that they were sort of giving me a basic training for the WASP. So it was much more about techniques and movements than you see some stories of like, and then I spent 2 years getting ready for this role. You know, it wasn't so much like that.
Thank you. Hello.
Hi. It's an honor to meet you. So my question is, I've noticed the trend of a lot of female superheroes like Black Widow, Captain Marvel, and now the Wasp. And I know that the MCU produced by Marvel Studios has become such a big like enterprise. So my main question was, if you were given the opportunity to have a Wasp movie, would you be in it? Like a standalone movie.
I would do anything I was told. I like the MCU and I'd like to stay. But I actually don't like the idea of a Wasp standalone film, because Ant-Man and the Wasp, since the very beginning in the comic books, were always a team. And really, they're kind of one of the only proper and true teams in the MCU. Otherwise, it's mostly a lot of individuals. And I love the team aspect of it. I love watching the interplay between Wasp and Ant-Man and Ant-Man and the Wasp. And for me, it's the most fun part of the film. So I don't love the idea of breaking them up, except if there was an all-female Avengers film.
Yeah!
I mean, I'm sure, you know, you've been asked this a million times already. I haven't asked you this, but of course in the comics, the Wasp is known for having so many cool costumes. This is not speculation, this is not spoiler, but you personally, would you be interested in kind of switching up the duds a little bit with each appearance?
In the original comic book, she was a fashion designer. Janet Van Dyne was a fashion designer, and she loved to change her costume. And there is absolutely nothing wrong with a woman liking clothes. I like clothes. But for me, it would be such a distraction from Hope being a very serious, no-nonsense scientist who really, I don't think she cares that much about what she puts on her body. You know, I think that when she goes to the store, she chooses things that are her practical, whatever she needs to get done, that's what goes on her body. And she goes home and gets done what has to be done. So, if Hope was a fashion designer, okay, maybe that'd be fun, but she's a scientist, so no.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Hi.
My question is, if Disney asked you to do to cross over into the Star Wars saga, would you do it because of your connection with J.J. Abrams?
When J.J. was first announced that he was going to do his first Star Wars film, I reached out to his producing partner for the first time ever since Lost ended. I've never requested anything from them ever before. I said, I want to be Leia. Make me Leia.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi there.
Hello.
By the way, they said Carrie Fisher is going to be Leia. I was like,
I'm the epic fan with Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit. My question is, was it hard or easy to just be Elvish in The Hobbit, or was it the hardest?
The hardest thing about speaking Elvish in The Hobbit was getting the intonation right. Because you can memorize a bunch of sounds, but then to actually make it sound like conversation is a whole other thing. You have to really make sure that you actually know what those sounds represent, and that they don't just become a blur of noise to you. So that was the hardest part.
Thank you.
I want to ask Rodrigo a question real quick, because, I mean, with your background, I know you've been an art professor as well. You've taught school, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
So when you come to a Comic-Con, and we're talking about, what's your background? Do you have any kind of nerdy background with this, or is this just kind of alien speak right now?
No, I love Lord of the Rings. For me, it's just one of the best trilogy ever made. And I know everything, and I used to watch also the making of those movies. And I was, it's the same fascination that I had for the movies, I had for the making the movie. So I saw the miniatures, the art that they did, and everything, and I was like, that's one of the things that I like about this pop culture. And all the superhero movies. There are so many artists that work in those movies. They're great. And I think maybe they're not in an exhibition with paintings on the walls, but they are there in these movies doing all those amazing things that we believe is real. When you see Thanos in the Avengers, you know there's a person there. It's not. And there's a bunch of artists that created that, so you can believe and the story can be told like that. So it's also an art thing. So that's why I love it. I love it, all the superhero movies also.
Whenever we're signing and somebody comes up in a costume and I don't know what it is, what costume is that? Because he knows all of it. Because he's a con goer and has been a con goer for how many years?
Yes, it is. Six years, and I like to, and I can memorize images very quickly, so I know if the costume is from movie one or two, if it's the Mark 42, you know.
That's good, yeah.
Yeah, so it's easy for me to see somebody in a costume, even if I never saw the movie, just if I see an image, I can tell it.
That's impressive, actually, yeah. Hi there, how are you?
Hi. So, on the subject of Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit, the world of Middle-earth is full of rich and memorable characters. Would you say that you are your own favorite character in that franchise? And if not, who is?
No,
yeah,
I
was
clear. It's pretty hard for me to be my own favorite character. I'm very self-critical when I watch myself. Who was my favorite character in the Hobbit trilogy? I think it was Thorin. I was really crushing on Thorin when I was watching those movies. And, you know, Richard Armitage is pretty great, but Thorin is a whole other level. I loved the dwarves. I was a huge fan of the original book. It was my favorite book when I was 13 years old. And I just was so invested in those dwarves and in their story. And this is a horrible thing to admit, but I sort of was like, enough with the elves already. Get back to the dwarves. I wanted to see the dwarves.
Thank you.
Thanks. Hello.
Hello. Between Lost, The Hobbit, and Ant-Man and the Wasp, what was your most favorite to work on?
My favorite one to work on was The Hobbit, and I think it was just such a fantasy fulfillment for me, because I had been fantasizing about being a woodland elf for so long when I was a little girl. I had lived in Middle Earth and read, you know, the entire trilogy of The Hobbit, and I started reading the Silmarillion. I never made it through that one when I was young, but I think it was just also a very ideal time in my life. I just fall madly in love with my partner. We just had a baby. I got the call, can you come to New Zealand in 2 months and start shooting, when I was laid up in bed having given birth. So I was still blissed out on, you know, birth hormones, whatever's going on up here when you have a baby. And it was a beautiful time. New Zealand, and if any of you have gone and visited and seen the Hobbit Shire, and, you know, it's like, it's incredible.
Yeah, after working in Hawaii to working in New Zealand, you have a knack for picking the good locations.
And then I ended up in Atlanta, Georgia.
Right. We only have time for probably like two more questions, guys. But I like your costume, and I like your one of those questions. Hi.
Hi. So I'll be doing my first ever audition for a play this fall. I've never auditioned for anything before, so do you have any advice for me?
Question.
Well, I can give you a very practical piece of advice, which is that if you have stage fright, when you're backstage waiting to go on and you have stage fright, the best way to eliminate the physical reality of stage fright is to do push-ups. It sounds crazy, but apparently what happens is your blood starts not getting up into your brain, and that's what's really going on. And when you do push-ups, you can push blood into the extremities of your body, and the nausea goes away, and like a lot of the nerves go away. But the main advice that I would give to any artist who is starting out, especially an actor, because it's very particularly difficult to hang on to this as an actor, is to be yourself. I bring myself to every role that I do, and sometimes I think I'm not a very good actor because I do that, because it's like all me somewhere inside of there. But then I realize that I'm all I've got, and if I try to be something I'm not, then it's going to read as false and fake, and people are going to not believe me. So just be you, and guarantee you is the best thing that you can be on that stage.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good question. Hi there.
Hi. My parents showed me Lost, and it's a show that really brings me and my family together. And I just wanted to know, out of like filming Lost and then doing like The Hobbit, if you had a favorite set that you were on, like a location.
Well, first of all, I want to tell you that what you just said is the thing that has always made me the happiest and most proud to have been a part of Lost. It has brought so many families together, so many people together. I meet people, I talk to people all the time, where like, I met my spouse because we were on a Lost forum together. Or, you know, my children and I had never felt more bonded than when we were watching Lost together. And that just makes me so happy, because that show was so wonderful and grueling to make. You know, we worked really hard, and we did it for 6 years, and so thank you for telling me that. And then, you know, favorite sets, favorite locations. Koloa Ranch on Oahu is where we shot a lot of the pilot. Do you remember the pilot of Lost? When there was a small group of us, we hiked up the mountains and we found the walkie-talkie, and then Charney goes, "Guys, where are we?" You know that part? That was the first time I'd ever been to Koloa Ranch, and it's just this magical, incredible, enormous, sacred place. It is full of pulsing aloha. You can just feel the essence of the spirit of Hawaii in that valley. And so 6 years later, when the show came to a close, and I was overwhelmed with emotion for what our crew had given to us as a cast that came, were strangers to the land, and a lot of them were locals, I took everyone back up into that mountain, and we had a party to be all parties. We lit up the whole valley all night, crew filled that valley with so much aloha. I felt like I was vibrating, and it was just a very special place.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. We are out of time, but I do want to end on a...
Sorry, talk a lot.
No, it's okay. I actually want to end on a speaker. Skywalker's question. First off, I know you've been selling a lot of books at your table. There's still some over there, I believe, right? So you guys can head back over there and pick up a book. A gentleman has one. He's holding it in the air, both of them. But really, I guess my final question is, we talk about Ant-Man and the Wasp, we talk about loss and everything, but for both of you, when you see this creation of yours on the big screen and you see people showing up and asking questions about it, just kind of in the panel by talking about the pride that you have in seeing it in other people's hands and in creating this thing out of your own mind.
Well, I'm a mom, first of all, and you know, I read books to my kids every day, and I really believe that what they're reading and just reading period is forming who they're going to become. And right now, it's a tricky time. Like, I feel like, I don't know if you guys feel this, but things feel precarious in the world. Things feel a lot more hopeless than I think we felt for a long while in this country and just globally. And I feel like whatever I could do to invest in children is something that is going to be very meaningful to me. I used to think maybe I would be a teacher. I used to work with kids, you know, all through my teen and 20 years, or 20s through my 20s, kids camps and Sunday school, and I volunteered at, you know, juvenile detention centers, and I love children and I believe in children, and I think often children are told, when you're older, you're going to change the world. You are the future. But I actually don't think that's accurate. I think it's right now they have the ideas to change the world. Right now is when they're most powerful. These little tiny beings have so much wisdom inside of them. And so I respect children and I'm proud to give them something that hopefully they will be stimulated by. Their imaginations will get firing because it's very imaginative and magical, and they will start creating their own stories and their own narratives for their own future and their own world.
And for me, I'm so proud that it was out. I'm so happy to see it come to life in people's hands and see that some of the children and then also the adults will bring their homes and read it and see all the illustrations, and maybe something will change after that. It's a great feeling because most of my works that I'm really proud of, some of them, most of them, nobody had ever seen. They are in my home, inside my sketchbook. It's not a public thing. It's not that I don't want to share, but it's okay. Stay with me in my home. But this is one of the works that I'm really, really proud of, and we're able to show to everyone. So there's a lot of soul in it. It's not just I didn't treat this book like if it was an illustration for a book or something like that. I really want to deliver more of a soul, more of emotion, and you see a different book every time you
open. And on that very poignant note, guys, look, you can go pick up the book. They're going to be heading back to their table soon, so go get it signed, go pick up the book, and give it up for, of course, the artist.